Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another episode of the West Coast Jazz Hour. This is episode 19. I checked the YouTube channel, and last week was 18 with Putter Smith, and this week it's number 19, and it's been a blast doing all of these interviews together with my co-host, the great piano player, composer, arranger, Josh Nelson, reporting for non-duty. today we have a very special guest. He's a super, super accomplished musician who has played with many, many musicians, including that he can actually say that he played with both Freddie Hubbard and Miles Davis as their piano player, which is, I think, a unique thing that nobody else can say. Besides that, he's the musical director for the Herbie Hancock Institute. And for International Jazz Day, he has worked on numerous movies, such as the last Bond movies, Skyfall and Spectre. So today we welcome piano player, composer, arranger, band leader, music director, John Beasley. Welcome, John.
Hello, gentlemen. How are you? Yeah.
Doing good.
So good to have you here.
Thank you for asking me to come and talk a little bit. Agree
with you. Yeah. So we're just gonna talk about some music that you've picked and pick your brain about music in general. And the thing that I was curious about, the question that I always started off with is, when did you move to LA, and what made you decide to move to LA?
My parents got jobs here. So I was their music teacher, and my dad was a professional piano player and bassoonist in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. He taught at North Texas and played in the Fort Worth and Dallas symphony and operas and played jazz piano gigs and stuff. And my mom was an orchestra and band director. So they were looking to get out of Texas. I was in high school, the last couple of years of high school. So I was ready. I was already into jazz, and because of the school there, I kind of grew up around a lot of those musicians. And some of those guys, of course, graduated before me and were already here. So when I moved out, I just kind of jumped in, and high schooler, ditcher at high school, and jazz musician at night. So that's how I got out, and I was excited because, man, when I first got here, man, it was like 7 or 8 major jazz clubs, that's what I did on weekends, I borrowed my parents' Volkswagen Beetle and played down to Hermosa Beach and Redondo and Dante's and the Parisian Room and Memory Lane and, a lot of stuff going on. It was cool.
Yeah. Did you go to a school for music?
I did not. There were only a few choices back then. I graduated in 77, right? So there were only like Berkeley, North Texas, I just left there, and Indiana, really. And that was like Denton, so, Bloomington, Denton. And I was already starting to work here and working with older musicians, which appealed to me. I guess I was like the preacher's kid, the music teacher's kid. I was like, I don't want to go to school for music anymore. So, I had this romantic notion of like the old days where you learn from older musicians and playing gigs and, band dues and people calling tunes you don't know on the set and, stuff like that.
And who were some of the older musicians that you played with in the LA area when you started gigging?
John B. Williams, great bass player. O.C. Smith.
Sing with
Count Basie early on. Right, my last year of high school, I met Billy Childs and Diane Reeves and all these guys because they had a gig here at the Comeback Inn. They had a band called Night Flight, and met Joey Heredia there. Mm. I did a couple gigs, a year with Jim Stafford, country artists, you know.
Okay.
I don't like spiders and snakes. You know, and that was great because, you know, on all these gigs, you learn something about how you can put yourself into it. And those country gigs, I just played blues, basically.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, I grew up in Texas, so in Louisiana, so I heard, you know, Porter Wagoner and Louisiana Hayride and all that every Saturday night. It's the only thing you get on TV back then, you know. So, you know, it was fun, you know. I did weddings. This is pre-DJ, right? So every hotel bar or lounge or bar had a band. There's tons of work, all kinds of stuff, you know. I mean, I played top 40 gigs, I played weddings, I played, you know, jazz gigs, R&B, tons of R&B gigs.
Mm-hmm.
And then disco came in, and disco gigs, you know. So it was thriving back then. There's a lot to do. Pre-DUI and pre-VCR.
Yeah.
Pre-home theater.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Josh, you want to take it away and that we listen to the first musical sure. example.
Yeah. John, I just want to thank you again for being here. And, you know, I've been a fan of yours for so long. And I just love, and this first track will kind of illustrate to me just the breadth of your, you know, your musical horizons, which are seem to be limitless in my opinion, because you're such a skillful writer and all your big band efforts lately, but I just love the other side of your personality, of your musical personality, which is kind of based in the, you know, fusion, maybe electronic world or whatever. And I just, everything you do is so musical. And this was actually one of the first things that I really, this record that I really delved into your sound and your world. And it's an amazing record. It's called Letter to Herbie from back in 2008. Resonance Records, and a great band with Jeff Tane Watts and Christian McBride and Roy Hargrove guesting on the great late Roy Hargrove guesting on it. But I just love this album, man, and you can just sense your respect for Herbie, but your willingness to take his music in these other directions. And I picked kind of a groovy, laid back, warm LA Tuesday vibe to start with, and this is Vein Melter. I thought we'd check this out. So for all those just joining, this is Kevin Van Den Elzen and I interviewing the great John Beasley, and a tune from his 2008 record, Letter to Herbie, and it's entitled Vein Melter. Thank you. Such a vibe, man.
Funny thing about that tune is that we, it was the middle of, there's another tune on there from a movie. The same tempo and the sort of the same fusion-y thing. Anyway, we just jammed for like 20 minutes, you know, on that one tune. And I think on, in the arrangement of that other tune, we kind of go to a little bit of that. And so I was, you know, mixing or editing the record and I said, well, that's cool. So we actually just made a new tune out of the long vamp. Yeah. The other side of the story is, of that record is that, you know, George Clayton, because I know you've been working with
him. I've done some stuff. Yeah.
And of course that's not George's taste at all.
Right.
You know? So, yeah, it was an interesting situation. And, you know, he had put that record company together and he said, yeah, I want you, you know, I'd like to sign you, but your first record, I want you to do Herbie Hancock. I was like, no way, man. Get a trumpet player, or a trombone player, or another instrument or something to do that. And so I said no, you know. And a couple months later, of all places, I was in Utah, in Ephraim, Utah, at Snow College teaching a summer camp, and I was in the practice room. And these practice rooms, man, they're Steinways. It's amazing. Steinway's at every practice. So I'm, you know, I'm going in there as much as I can. And I start messing around with Tell Me a Bedtime Story, the turnaround.
Yeah.
Ding, 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 ding. Right. Because this is difficult. I just wanted to shed on something.
Yeah.
And then a light bulb went up and I went, oh, if I could, what if I turn that progression into the Maiden Voyage rhythm? Ding, 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 ding.
Which I love.
And I was like, oh, that kind of works.
Yeah.
Well, does the melody work over it? And it did, you know? So at that was the point I called George back and said, I think I can flip Herbie's music enough to sort of take the bullseye off my
head. Right. That was the other track that I was going to actually play.
Yeah, it's so that's great. I haven't heard that in a long time.
Yeah, it's so effective how it works. It totally works. You're right, the change, everything. This one somehow just grabbed me in this like different, and Roy's on, you know, Roy's on both, but...
Yeah.
I was in a mood for that.
That's nice you say. You know, I'm a big fan of yours too, man.
I've been
listening to you for a while now too, so appreciate what you said.
Oh, well, we got a lot of music to get through with you today, man. Yeah, killing. Well, thanks. Yeah, and a tall order to do that for one of our idols. You know, I idolize Herbie too, but I think you did a fantastic job, and I encourage everyone to check out that record, Letter to Herbie, because it's your personal take on his vibe and his music, and the band is just killing. So yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. What was it like to play with Roy? Had you worked with him before?
Ever? Yeah. Yeah. You know, in the '90s, I was in New York a lot when I was working with Steely Dan. I was like, and we lived there for a couple of years in 2000. So a couple blocks from his house and down the village or his apartment. And so we kind of get to know each other and, on these international jazz days. Actually, that was before international jazz day. You know, he was always at Smalls or some joint, and he happened to be in LA. George had flown Christian and Tane out to do the record, and Roy just happened to be there, and we got a hold of him, and he came in.
Wow.
And played. Yeah.
That's so cool.
Super talented guy.
Yeah.
Incredibly talented.
Absolutely. Yeah, Kevin.
Yeah,
away, friend.
Yeah, I wanted to go into Monkestra because you actually just released a new record. Monkestra plays John Beasley, and I would like to actually play something off of the new record. And because there's a lot to choose from now that you actually made like three volumes with the big band. But I thought that this song was very cool to show, which is the first track on the album, which is Steve-O. And I'm going to share the song right here. All right, so here we have Steve-O from Monkestra plays John Beasley.
Thank you.
Killing.
Steve-o.
Yeah.
Keep
right.
going.
Yeah, right. Keep going. Yeah. So I thought it was actually interesting to talk about this because I had the pleasure of playing a couple times with the Monkestra as part of preparations for the recording.
Yeah.
You've played with my band also almost a year ago. I think it's like very interesting to maybe talk about like how did you put Monkestra together, because it's a huge undertaking nowadays to start and maintain an 18-piece big band, and you seem to be doing a pretty darn good job with keeping all of those guys together and keeping the momentum going with that. So I'm curious about how did you put Monkestra together?
Well, a lot of it was luck, you know. I mean, I'd started, there was a band called the Luckman Jazz Orchestra here, Cal State LA, led by Charles Owens. And before that, there was a flute player that had the band.
Newton? Great flute player. James Newton?
James Newton.
Yeah.
And a really cool band. Mm-hmm. And they did a night of Monk, and they hired me to write an arrangement on Ask Me Now and forget the other one. So during that process, I was like, oh, well, I can kind of actually learn. It kind of started with Letter Herbie. You know, how do you find your own self into somebody else's tune in a way, your own sound? And so I discovered that I could, you know, stop tempo, play free for a while. I could take liberties harmonically, which I really love to do. You know, kind of put my own spin on these tunes. And so I had two tunes, and then I did Epistrophe. And, you know, at that, you know, I'm changing the meter, the groove, you know, it's an Afro-Cuban thing. It goes back and forth. There's a free section in it. And so I had those three tunes. So I called up Brian Swartz and Bijan, and they helped me kind of fill out the trumpet section. And then Francisco helped fill out the trombone section, and I met Lamar and Ryan Dragon, who's a beast, and mm-hmm. Wendell, you know. Wendell's like my Butter Jackson of the band, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so all these personalities, right? And I called Shep, of course, because we're both Thad Mel freaks, and he's got the Jerome Richardson thing, and Bijan's got the Snooki thing, you know. Bijan sat next to Snooki and Clayton Hamilton band for years, you know.
Yeah.
So he was his mentor. I really wanted that sound, you know. And and then I needed doublers, you know. So, you know, Lure and, you know, Tommy Peterson, you know, because I was writing a lot for clarinets and all that stuff. So we met at the Union and, you know, we had fun, you know, it was just fun. So I started writing more tunes, and then I had enough for one gig, one set at the Blue Whale. And those are actually the videos you see, you know.
Oh, yeah?
Well, that was our first gig, you know. Of course, why you do a video on your first gig, I don't know. But, you know. And then a while later, I got enough money together to go record half the first record and then shop that for a record. And once we started shopping, we realized that Monk's Centennial was coming up. So the record company helped get an agent. And that first release, I think we did 35, 40 concerts that first year.
Wow.
Yeah. Just sort of luck, man. I don't know. You know, it's I guess it's unique. And what's really cool is how it's evolved. You know, it's like those guys have made the guys in the band are so killing. You know, they Adam Schroeder, you know, lives in Vegas. He comes in for the gigs, you know, and they make a point to try to make it. You know, I haven't had too many subs, and I've just been lucky, you know. Those guys they're into it, and now I write for them, you know.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah, that's how we got together.
Yeah, and as of now, because sometimes also you play with, like, a sextet version of the
septet.
Big band. Oh,
four
septet.
Horn. Yeah,
right.
Four horns.
Right. And you
Yeah,
and
that's
have
just because people can't afford a big band, so we've been
right.
able to work more, especially in Japan and in Europe. And then we've done a lot of the radio bands in Europe with this music,
Yeah.
so that's been fun. It's always fun to hear sort of another band's take on the tunes, and to be kind of open about that. It's not classical music here, it's social music, so let these
Yeah.
guys have their vibe on it, I like
Yeah. Yeah, and I guess it opened doors as well for you to arrange also for those kind of bands, like for the radio bands.
Yeah, I mean, I was doing a little bit of that before, but now I've got some relationships over there. The next thing, I just did a Duke Ellington project with the HR band. Metropole, we did Maria's record, Maria Mendez, who actually we got nominated for a Latin Grammy today for best arrangement for that record. That's a beautiful record.
Congratulations.
I'll have
That's
to
a
check it
she's
out.
a she's a really fine artist. She's
Wow.
really great.
Congratulations. That's
And
fun.
let's see, going back, we have a Charlie Parker project with strings and big band. We were actually supposed to be at the Bowl this summer, and then Irvine, had a bunch of gigs canceled. But the SRW is gonna
No.
orchestra is gonna record it next month,
Okay.
a couple of gigs. And then the next thing with HR in January is the musical Return to Forever, like sort of reimagined.
Wow.
Yeah, I have no idea what I'm going to do with that, but
Oh my gosh. I'm sure you'll come up with
I don't
something.
know, man. It's like stuff's
Wow.
all so three com through composed almost already.
Yeah.
It'd be fun though.
Yeah, the HR definitely, in my opinion, has like a lot of very unique projects that they bring in, like a different kind of repertoires. And just a little while ago brought in the complete Brian Blade Fellowship
Yeah,
band
right.
to play, and McNeely arranged that wonderfully. So the HR band does a lot of unique projects, more so than what Metropole does or what WDR does. Both equally great, but HR seems to do like a lot of unique stuff, which I dig. So, but that's, like that's super cool. It's cool, super cool to hear that it's actually like sort of like a chain of events that led up to Monkestra. And as like sort of like in the vein of like you don't, of course, you don't have to do that much effort to keep, like your band members satisfied, as you say, because they all love to play your music, and I've experienced that personally myself as well. But what is now in these current, in well, let's not think about COVID for a second, but what do you think in like normal days is the most important thing to keep a band like that going nowadays?
Well, I always say I have to feed the beast. So when I have other gigs that pay money, I try to hire those guys and, pay back the favor, because we're not
Right.
getting any money in this way. We're not in this. We were in this for the money. We're in the wrong business, right?
That's right.
Especially, with the big band. So, I try to, if I have other gigs, try to pay back the favor.
Yeah. Right on. I'll hand it over to Josh.
Thanks. Yeah, man, the record is killing the new record. And Shep played, didn't we play Song for Dub with Shep?
Yeah.
Man, that tune and your arranging is so beautiful. I mean, it just sends shivers up my spine just to think about it. It's probably the one I've played the most off that one because it's just so
Thank you.
gorgeous.
And Shep, man, alto
Oh,
flute solo, right?
yes.
Man.
Yes.
So great, man. Yeah. So, the idea that Kevin had for this show originally was kind of his love and our shared love for 50s, 60s, West Coast based jazz recordings. But I love how it's evolved. And you were saying earlier off the air that that wasn't a part of music that necessarily you identify with, but that you're here on the West Coast, it makes you all the more relevant, and that you're such an important sound of the West Coast sound to me, that along with people like Billy Childs, another favorite of mine, Bill Cunliffe, the greats. But you did bring up one record that I thought we could just listen to together and just talk
Sure.
about. And it's made at least one appearance on this show before. It's the score to the 1956 Otto Preminger movie, The Man with the Golden Arm,
Right.
with that great score by Elmer Bernstein, which
Yeah, I think I
features.
was about 12. Somehow that record made it home from North Texas, I guess. My dad brought it home or
Oh,
something.
cool.
And I remember staring at the cover, and then, it's got Conti Condoli, I think Shorty Rogers.
Yep.
Bernhard on trombone, and
Yep. Shelley.
Shelley Mann. Is Ray Brown on that record?
No, probably.
Before Ray moved out,
Yeah,
maybe.
maybe Red.
Yeah, Red Callender.
Yeah.
Dick Nash, I think,
The Cats,
and then,
yeah.
Ted and I are about the same age. So I remember hanging out with him while we were in high school. He was up in the valley. This is a great alto saxophone and flute player.
Bud Shank.
Bud
Bud
Shank,
Shank's on it. Yeah, Bob
Anyway,
Cooper, yeah.
really cool, vibey, jazzy, not necessarily swinging, because it's Elmer Bernstein, it's a movie score, but interesting sound.
Yeah, I thought we'd just listen to the main title together and maybe talk about Elmer and if maybe he had some influence on your writing or other big band writers I'm curious about. So here we go. This is the main theme to The Man with the Golden Arm by Elmer Bernstein. Just fun.
That's been a long time. I've
Yeah.
been trying to get these Monkestra records to sound like that. I would
Ooh.
still love to do a record where, it really has a room and that much echo. You can't get an engineer these days to put that much echo. You could
Yeah.
even pay them gazillions of money, they won't do it. I tried. I tried. I love that sound.
Right?
Yeah.
Got a vibe. Have you seen the movie? Have you seen it?
Yeah, you know, yeah. And as a kid, I was like, God, what is this movie?
I know, but, right? Sinatra's so just messed up and desperate. And
yeah.
Carl Malden, and, you know, that scene with Shorty Rogers where he tries to play drums and it's a mess. Mm-hmm. And it's, but the score, yeah, there's so many other good parts of the score, but I like that you suggested we, or just added it to your.
Yeah, that was one of my first records, actually. Mm-hmm. That and Shaft.
Oh, cool.
You know, and then I guess I did really like a lot of movie scores back then. Shaft, and then Quincy, Smackwater Jack, because it has Ironside and the Anderson tapes on
That's
it.
That's great. I think we're going to show something from that, right, Kevin?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, and that's when Quincy moved to L.A., and I was a total Thad Jones and Quincy Jones freak back then, you know.
Yeah.
Still am, of course.
Yeah. You and me both.
Yeah. And that, and you mentioned earlier Thad Jones and Mel Lewis Orchestra, so a big, huge influence on your writing.
Yeah, but you really hear the Kenton thing in that score.
Yeah, absolutely, and maybe right? in the score Ellington's Anatomy of a Murder a little bit.
Right,
she didn't write many, but yeah, Kenton for sure.
Kenton, right? I used to Artistry and Rhythm. I used to wear that record out too. Oh, the West Coast. That's a West Coast record, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. He's from Balboa.
Yeah, the band started in Balboa.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the same guys. In fact, that's one of the things, of course, when you're getting into jazz, especially when you have records, was, you know, I had Artistry and Rhythm probably first. And I said, oh, Milt Bernhardt, Vito Musso, the Condoli Brothers. Oh, mm-hmm. They're on this record. Oh, right. It's a store. Oh, I'll go check that record out, you know?
Yeah, you see a lot of the same guys on all of those records of the LA studio scene, that's for sure.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Well, and cool. I think that might, because the jazz arrangements on The Man with the Golden Arm were made actually also by Shorty Rogers, if I'm not mistaken.
That's right.
I see.
Yeah, and Bill Holman actually said to us in a couple episodes earlier that he was credited with making the Stan Kenton band swing, but he said that actually Shorty Rogers was the one, in his opinion, that actually made the Kenton band swing. Okay. So it's actually kind of funny that you mentioned that.
Right.
But I hear that definitely very clearly. I've heard Monkestra also a couple of times live, and I hear that very clearly in your big band writing that there is, which is incredible to me, how you have put those influences all together. Thad Jones, Mel Lewis, Duke Ellington, some Oliver Nelson stuff in there as well. Mm-hmm. Lots of different.
Well, if you're gonna steal, you gotta steal from the best, you know?
That's right, that's right. That's definitely true. So I love it that, and you can, you can hear that also in Steve-O, which we listened to just now, that all of those different aspects are basically shown in the arrangement, but then it's like a super cohesive thing and it's all very, very logical, but I'm like, oh, that's Ellington and that's Thad Jones, Mel Lewis, and that's this, and that's that, and, you know, and different styles and all of that. So it's just super cool how you've made that into, you know, like your own thing, definitely.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Absolutely. And just to check in with some folks that are watching, we have Jamie Tate here.
Hey, Jamie.
Perla Bataya is here.
Pearl.
Yeah.
We went to school together.
I played with her once, long time ago. Jonathan Moore, great bass player. Lori Bell's here.
Wow.
Brian Swartz. Hey, Brian. Dan Schnell and Alex Bond.
That's Brian playing trumpet, the trumpet solo on Steve-O.
I thought that I recognized him.
The first part, when we were laying it down, when he was playing, I was like, the first part, I was like, oh, man, because he liked the other take, but I liked that take, and was like, oh, man, that's like Nat Adderley, man. It sounds like, yeah.
Brian, I think, is a gem in L.A., and he was one of my first experiences leading a band as like a 19, 20-year-old, and he graciously agreed to play with me. I'm a big Brian fan.
Oh, yeah. He's got a nice record out now too.
Yes.
That's true.
Yeah,
And he's a fantastic writer too. He brought a couple of
absolutely.
pieces into my band actually, and I think one of the last rehearsals that we did this year before everything shut down, we played a piece by his, and I think I Mean You is an arrangement from
That's
him
his
on.
arrangement. Yeah, exactly.
So, yo, Brian.
Yeah, my buddies Dan Schnell and Alex Bonham are watching. What's up,
Ah,
guys?
cool. I miss all you guys,
Right,
man.
the
Ooh.
cats. This is our hang
Ah.
right
Yeah.
now.
I'm
Tom
missing the
Meek's
cocktail,
here.
Josh.
I know, right? We didn't do a cocktail tonight. Tom Meek's here. He had a question for you, actually, John. Tom Meek says, "I recently learned John did some gigs with Tribal Tech 30 years ago. I heard audio that was apparently recorded at NAMM in 1990. Curious to hear your comments."
Wow. Man, I'm sure it was loud. Yeah, great band. I think Joey Heredia was on the gig, and Willis and I used to have a band called Audio Mind, with Tavoloni, Steve Tavoloni, Gary, and Vinny. And we used to play gigs unheard of in LA in a way. We just make up sets. We just play, and improvise. When I joined, well, when I did these few gigs with Tribal Tech, I was shocked at how much written out music it was, because I knew Gary from the other side. And it was like playing in a big band. And especially with the keyboard, it was totally orchestrated, which was a nice challenge for me. But after a while, I like to kind of. I like to take off and go different places as well. So I felt a little inhibited, not inhibited, but shackled a little
Right.
bit, after a while. It's all set up for those guys to really do the thing. And the writing is brilliant. I mean, that's a great band. And those guys are so talented. But yeah, I was, we're talking like 7, 10-page charts, basically. That,
Wow. Didn't know it was scored like that.
and then patch changes,
Yeah.
just like,
Wow. He
which I was
says
never great
yes,
at.
Joey was on it, is what Tom Meek said. Yeah. That's
cool.
cool. Well, thanks for that. Cool.
Travel to.
Yeah. Cool. Kevin, you
Yeah,
wanna
I
do
think we're
something?
gonna. Yeah, I think we're gonna continue with some music. You mentioned his name already once before, Quincy Jones, and he moved out here to LA in the '60s. And you mentioned a couple, two records, Body Heat and what was the other one?
Smackwater Jack.
Smack Water Jack. Thank you. And you pointed out that his arrangement on Along Came Betty is definitely worth listening to. So we're going to listen to Quincy Jones's arrangement of Along Came Betty on Body Heat.
Can I just say something though?
Of course.
What's great about this is the casting. I mean, that's the other thing about Quincy is that his casting, man, who he puts on what track. This is actually Bernard Purdy on drums, Chuck Rainey on the bass, Kirby on Rhodes, and Hubert Laws. I think Eric Gale probably playing guitar. And I had a couple of opportunities to conduct his music for other bands. I think the last time we did it was at Manhattan School of Music, right?
Wow.
So he went to the vault, because people went, they call it the vault, and got me all these scores and all these parts. And one of them I wanted was Along Came Betty, which he cut a lot of different times. He cut on Mercury. But a lot of the same writing was there. And I think what he would do is he'd just go through the score again and go, "All right, don't want that this time, but I want this color here." So you can hear some of that old writing still. And he did that also again with Walkin'. There's the famous one on Gulamatari. To me, that's the
That's
version of
killer,
that,
yeah.
besides Miles. But he cut it back in the Mercury days too. And some of the writing's there, and some of, and then, he just had rhythm section play. So a little Quincy trivia there.
That's cool.
And people often forget about his whole like big band library because people know him as producer and Thriller and all of that.
Yeah,
But
yeah.
like when he started out first as a trumpet player and then immediately started writing for all of that stuff, and all of those first albums that he made, like Birth of the Band and playing hip hits and plays for hip dancers and all of that stuff. You know, like it's all so amazing and so
yeah, they're all
amazingly
like
arranged.
2 or 3 minutes long. That's it.
Yeah, yeah.
Super short.
Yeah, yeah. But he has like such a strong, strong.
I think
vibe.
Mel is on some of that stuff, right? Mel Lewis is on.
Yes.
Early stuff.
Yeah. So Quincy had like, I don't know exactly like where this come from, but I've checked out a bunch of records from Quincy, and he has like the most underground drummers on those recordings that you can imagine. Like his drummer that went on tour with him a lot was Joe Harris, and I actually spoke with Hammer about this, and Hammer met Joe Harris once, and he retired as a player because he became a tennis instructor, because Hammer is also like a pretty serious tennis player. So he ran into like Joe Harris and met him randomly, and he said like, yeah, I don't play anymore, I'm a tennis instructor now.
Oh, wow.
And Stu Martin is a drummer that I see a lot on the early Quincy stuff. I've seen Ed Shaughnessy also a couple
right.
of times.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah, I think.
New York Studio Cats.
Yeah, most definitely. Mm-hmm. On this one, I've seen also a couple LA guys, like Chuck Findley is in on this recording of Body Heat on a couple tracks. And
yeah, this was recorded in LA, I believe, or most of it.
Yeah.
Probably the suite and you know, the horns and, yeah, it was probably before Hubert and Herbie moved out, so. And then, Slide Hyde, you know, those guys are on board.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let's take a listen to Along Came Betty.
Amazing bass part this guy come up with.
Who says you can't make a jazz standard groove?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
That is so killing. Oh man. Is
It's
that?
amazing how Hubert Laws,
Yeah.
with all that energy around him, can still play flute. You can't blow hard on a flute, man. You get that same fat tone, but create energy without, overblowing or whatever,
Right.
Imagine him in the headphones, in the room. He's like, can't hear himself, but he's cool. He can, he knows how to do
Yeah.
that.
So how did Quincy have like an influence on you as like a musician, as composer? Or did he also have an influence on you as like a producer type?
Yeah, I mean, he always know it's Quincy, right? He's got his sound, even though he's not a player per se, right? It's his casting, his taste, his impeccable taste with songs that he chooses. And he never overwrites.
Right.
That's that bassy stuff. He'll take it out. Like that chart, if you go back and listen to the Mercury version, I think it's, like I said, it's the same chart. He's just whittling away,
Right.
And then he's always in the technology and kind of looking for the new instruments and new way of cutting. And also, I'm from that generation where we love bebop and all that, but during the 70s radio, Stevie, all songs in the key of life, it happened when I was in high school. Like intelligent R&B, like great songwriting, James Taylor, so you could, because of Herbie and Quincy and those guys, turn a flipping a standard like that and playing and kind of going into other kind of grooves, it was like, it was a natural thing for me to pick up a synthesizer and play Rhodes and play R&B gigs and still go home and play bebop and listen to Coltrane or whatever. And it was a much more broad spectrum of gigs you could do and of interest, And then he scored movies. I always wanted to work on scored movies and my themes, and yeah, huge influence on me. And that record cover, Walking in Space, I mean, I was probably 13 when I saw that at a record store. I went, who's that? It was a boy crush, I mean, I was a bit of freaky kid, at that age, I guess people had what, Lou Brock posters or Jerry West posters or Milt Chamberlain posters on their walls. I had Quincy and Coltrane and I was a I had to like hide my music when friends would come over and put on the Zeppelin or put on the Hendrix, not really share my stuff. Yeah.
That's cool.
This was Texas, it's not Holland where people have,
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, I never had to
You
like
never had that?
hide. Yeah, I never had to hide my love for jazz in high school. My friends were actually like, "What are you listening to?" And I'm like, "Oh, this guy Joshua Redman. Oh, sounds actually kind of cool."
Yeah, exactly.
Some pretty hip friends back in
God
those
bless
days.
the
Yeah, exactly.
Dutch.
I do too. It's gonna take a little while for me to get out there once, like once this COVID thing is all dealt with, So, but it is what it is. Josh, do you have something to listen to, or can I show that other Quincy
Oh, go ahead.
thing
Yeah.
from
No, go ahead. We'll do
Smackwater?
something after. Yeah.
Yeah,
Go ahead.
because now that we're busy with Quincy either way,
Stay in
Smack.
Quincy land.
Yeah. And
What was your
I'm
first Quincy record, Josh?
first one, probably Walking in Space.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that one. But also, what's the Bossa Nova one that got so
Yeah,
huge?
right.
That
Yeah.
one, I remember seeing the cover and just like, I'm like, man, what does he not do? Like that one. And then some of his other big
And then
band records.
the
The
dude is a great
Dude,
record
I
too.
mean, it's like he's unstoppable. When I met him, when I was on the road with Natalie Cole, he was at a few gigs, you know, just hanging out back, you know, I'm sure you've been
Holding
around. I was
court.
like, oh my God, Quincy Jones, I can see him. I'm on stage and I can see him sitting there just, you know, listening, you know. I'm just so nervous. And then he was so down to earth and cool when I talked to him, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great.
I found the track that you wanted to play, Bees, the theme from the Anderson tapes.
How long is it?
It is 5 minutes and 17 seconds.
Is that okay?
Yeah, that's just on the cusp of our maximum.
Okay.
So here we go from Smack Water Jack. Oops, I need to sh share again because I disabled that. Smack Water Jack and the theme from the Anderson tapes.
Ready, Hubbard. Dave Grusin.
Ah.
Thank you. think Quincy was the first guy I ever heard to mix synthesizers with, you know, with not with jazz, but with big band kind of writing. You know?
Right.
All those keyboards. That was Grusin playing all that stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, and then Toots always has to make an appearance somewhere.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, frankly, to use a harmonica, you know, Quincy, you know, I never heard of a harmonica player before Quincy Jones' record. You know, I'm sure Toots was all over the place, but for us in the States, it was like, wow, that's amazing, you know?
Yeah. And these records for me personally, I didn't know because I was going back more to what he did in like the 60s and all of that. But this stuff has like the same taste that Quincy has, and especially when the brass comes in, I'm like, yep, that's Q for sure. So
and it's the same bassy kind of idea, you know, big blast and then boom, down, you know.
Yeah.
It's the dynamics, you know.
And I realize I think probably a lot of my original hearing him was through film scores. And his sound, I mean, yeah, the dude and the other one you mentioned, Walking in Space, but also like The Wiz, that movie. I didn't know it was him until after, but I watched that movie about a bazillion times. I was with it. I'm like, oh man, of course, that's Quincy. The Pawnbroker, Rod Steiger. Yeah. That's a beautiful theme he wrote for that movie. Mm-hmm. Oh, the theme from The Pawnbroker and In the Heat of the Night. And man, what a badass.
Well, it was Walking in Space. And then there was Gulamatari. And then Body Heat, and then this record. This record also has a really great version of What's Going on it, like a super long, and Brown Ballad. It's gorgeous on there.
Yeah.
The Ray Brown tune.
Oh, okay.
You know? And I think Ray was managing Quincy at that point.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And another sort of trivia is that, it's more conspiracy theory, I think. On these records, this era of records, there's this great blues piano playing on a lot of tracks. And it's listed as something brown, or it's just kind of a normal name, you know? And, Bobby something, right? And I've never been able to track this guy down again. But it sounds a lot like Ray Charles.
Oh, really?
And I think it's like a pseudonym, you know?
Yeah.
You know, I think it's Ray. He's on a lot of that stuff, man. And yeah. You know, they were so tight, you know?
Uh-huh.
That's like, killing.
Like Cannonball, Buckshot Galifunk, you know?
E. Dankworth, Wynton Marsalis.
What's Wynton's?
E. Dankworth.
Oh. And then George Duke had one. George Duke played on a lot of records that, you know, different names and stuff. Yeah.
Interesting. Wow.
Mine is Joao. Actually, I shouldn't say. Joao Abuela, which is in Portuguese, John Wasp. Beasley, Wasp, you know.
Yeah.
a little trivia, love it.
I'm gonna be looking at that now every time when I see Joao, that name.
You're not gonna want to listen to those records. That's why it's there.
Yeah. But you mentioned we heard also a little bit of Freddie in that recording, and you've worked both with Freddie and Miles. And I was actually like curious, like, were those two guys like, how did they? How did they attribute it to your development as a musician, like in more of an improvisational type of sense? Like, was Miles very supportive of, you know, like your improvisation skills and listening to different kinds of music, that kind of stuff that I'm curious about?
Yeah, well, Miles, you know, I was in Miles' band in 1989, and by that time it was pretty much a set kind of thing you did. It was like playing in an R&B band, if you will, and that, you know, everything was orchestrated a lot until we got into these long vampy solos and then we'd comp, right? So with Miles, you know, I'd worked with quite a few really incredible artists before that, but I think he was the most dedicated cat I ever saw. You know, he was always listening to music. You go to his room, he'd be painting or, you know, his trumpet would be on the couch and he'd be just listening to little snippets of music that he liked, you know, like Stockhausen, you know, a couple bars over and over again on those, you know, back those days it was a Walkman cassette player, you know, rewind, you know, try to figure that out. He's listening to this Caribbean band called Kassav, which is a really funky band. And then he'd be talking about, you know, the wardrobe guy, about, you know, designing a new outfit, you know, for the show. And then, you know, he listened to every show every night or in the next morning. And he would have a comment for all of us, you know. Either we get called in separately to the dressing room or just before we hit the stage, we'd get everybody together and be pointing out stuff that he wanted different or try a new thing. Or, you know, he was always into it.
Wow.
Yeah. And he wasn't feeling good either, you know. He was not feeling great. And, you know, there was a cot off the side of the stage that sometimes he would have to, in the set, you know, he had to go lay down for a little while. And he'd always come back. Mm. And I don't think he had to be out there on the road like that, you know, right. But he really wanted to. He didn't want to stop. Yeah.
That's so cool.
And the Freddie was like my college education in a way, you know. I started with him, I think I was 21, maybe, something like that, 22. Shep got me on one of the gigs. Mm. He recommended me after Billy left.
Yeah.
And I just stuck, you know, he kept calling. And the thing about Freddie was that, you know, it was, you know, do or die. So that, you know, it was intense, and it was, you know, the first tune of every set was blazing, you know. And then we'd ask him, you know, like, well, why you do that first tune like that? Well, you know, whatever, you know. He said, well, if you notice, you know, you're a lot more relaxed the rest of the set, right? You know? And we all were. It was like downhill from that. Point, you know? And he would just play solo, you know, these long, brilliant, archy solos. He would come down like in the middle, like he was done. He was, and then he would just play light for a while and then bring it back up again. It's like two solos in one. Wow. Or after I would solo, he would play another badass solo, you know? And he used to be on me a lot about comping, you know, which was great.
Really?
You know, you kept, don't stop feeding me, you know? Don't feed me, you know? Okay. And, you know, calling a tune, you just start playing a ballad. You just start playing it, you know, and if you didn't know it, you know, I would pray that the bass player would know it. But kind of get in there. But if I didn't, you know, you just have to figure it out.
Beautiful.
And then, of course, being on the road with him was always an adventure, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We've heard already a couple stories.
Yeah, but a very sweet guy, actually. Very sweet guy underneath that kind of macho shell, you know. Very, very sweet guy.
Huh. Yeah. Awesome. Well, thanks for sharing that. Josh, you said that you had also something to show for the last music example.
Yeah, I mean, I would go back to where we started, actually, with Letter to Herbie. Just a little piece, if that's cool, John, unless there's something else you want to...
No, please.
Honest to show. Yeah, the Bedtime Voyage tune, because I love what you did with it. And it's, we'll probably won't get to the whole thing, but maybe it's 6 minutes, so maybe half of it. But
okay.
I just really love this whole record and what you did with Herbie's music. And yeah, so... One last go at this great record. Let me just turn the sound on. Cool. And thanks, you know, for joining us. If you're just joining, we have John Beasley on with us, our special guest, and we're listening to a record he did back in 2008 called Letter to Herbie. This is his song, or I guess, is it technically your tune? Because it's not. He's like, shh.
Yeah. it's two Herbie Hancock tunes.
Right.
Mixed, but mashed up together.
But you wouldn't say, yeah. So.
No, there's no copyright for that.
Right.
He's still, it's no, it's
it's still his,
it's not public domain yet. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
All right. Well, this is Bedtime Voyage.
Lucky that it worked.
I know, man. You got the 5/4 bars in there. So cool. Love how you navigate the 5/4 bars in that.
I was holding my breath the whole
yeah,
time.
Yeah, right. Well, you played so lyrically over it. I play this tune a lot with, you know, Lorca Hart, right?
Yeah, love Lorca. Where is Lorca? Is
Lorca, he Bay Area, San Francisco. Yeah. He moved up there probably, man, it's probably been 12 years.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Wait, somewhere in there. Yeah, he moved up. But this is like his, I mean, we always play this on the gig. I mean, tell me a bedtime story. That is,
yeah.
And every time we get to that part, Lorca does his, you know, Billy Higgins type smile.
Yeah, right.
Anyway, man.
It's Billy Hart smile, actually. Right?
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
it's more that. Yeah, but what a great arrangement of those two tunes, and great solo from you. And yeah, very.
Thank
cool.
you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Any? Do you play this? Play any of this music anymore? This from this record? Do you ever
play
these charts?
Yeah, I usually play that tune and Eye of the Hurricane. We play that a bit.
Mm.
Cool. You know, when there's a trio gig or a
right.
That's great. Small group gig or whatever.
Yeah, and that was Chris McBride on the bass, the wonderful bassist, and Jeff Tane Watts on drums, and Roy Hargrove. Wow.
Slamming. And Tavoloni playing flute. And,
right.
Yeah.
Wow. Very cool.
So maybe to round things up, John, now that you just released a new Monkestra record, where do you think that you're going to go from here with like Monkestra or a different project of yours?
This project, the reason why it's called Monkestra Plays John Beasley is that, you know, the other two records had, it was all Monk tunes.
Yeah.
You know, I miss writing, you know, for myself. So there's original music on it. There's a Charlie Parker tune on it. There's a, what else is a, there's a Duke Ellington tune we did Come Sunday.
Yeah.
And then half of it's big band, half of it's the septet with four horns. And then there's a trio and a quintet record. Anyway, I needed to transition away from the big band thing for a minute, and this is the way to sort of transition that way. doesn't mean that Monkestra won't work or do gigs. It's just that I'm not just a big band guy, I guess, you know? And, this is an opportunity to sort of bridge that gap. You know? But I'm writing more and more for a large ensemble all the time. Like I said, next month I'm going to Europe to do this Charlie Parker Reimagined project with the radio orchestra in Germany, SRW band, and that's with strings, and we flipped a bunch of those tunes, Laura, and then a mashup of Scrapple from the Apple and Alucha, kind of mixed together. It's like in five, and sort of, to me, it's VJ Iverish. I was kind of looking for that thing.
Nice.
What else did we do? I remember April, Coco and Cherokee. What was cool about this project, though, is with my friend Magnus Lindgren.
Yeah.
Great arranger from Sweden. And we decided that we would share the scores back and forth, co-writing from a distance, but, actually down to the orchestrating and the writing. So I would write a little bit and send it to him. He'd write a little bit and send it back. It was a very interesting way.
That's cool.
I'd never written like that, co-wrote songs many times and produced records and all that kind of stuff, but to actually co-write an arrangement like that was a unique and very, very cool, experience.
Cool. I'll look forward in hearing that, because I'm sure it's going to be streamed, because all of those radio orchestras they seem to be streaming right now. So
yeah, we've got a couple of live gigs, but mostly it's a record and a video. Yeah.
Ah, great!
Look forward to hearing it.
That's definitely.
So that's sort of next. Those charts have been done for probably 4 or 5 months already. Because we had a bunch of gigs in July with Monkestra playing that music. With a bowl in August, Irvine, we had a gig in back east. We had a gig in, anyway, we had, like everybody else with stuff. So it'll be interesting to hear this with this band and to kind of have it, have a week to record a record, there. This Monkestra record was done, the big band stuff was done in one day, everybody live. So it's a nice luxury to have.
Yeah.
What are you guys doing, Kevin? You gonna put more of that stuff out? Or?
I'm working on getting the stuff from the Thad Jones Malouz tribute that we did. I'm trying to put that on a record. Everything is mixed of that, but it's now on the back burner because of this COVID situation, definitely. Whenever it doesn't feel right to me right now to start like a crowdfunding thing,
sure,
or something like that to get to gobble money together and all of that. So once it's once we go back to some form of normalcy, I'll get back to that stuff. And I have been talking with our friend Jasper Thompson to get some ideas about how to put it out there, basically. But
and Josh, we were talking about how we put records out during COVID, and that Josh, you got a new project out, right?
Yeah it was recorded in Japan in 2019 with Dan Schnell and Alex Bonham, my trio.
Yeah,
and it came out in May and self-released. The last couple albums I did with Origin Records in Seattle.
Oh, yeah.
You probably know them, John Bishop and
I had some friends that have done records. So yeah
I cool. love Origin. They're great. Putting out some two or three videos during the quarantine from the Discovery Project. Kind of, I did one recently that was for the new Mars rover Perseverance. That
right, I saw that. That was I love all that stuff, man.
Isn't that great? Yeah,
very cool.
So collaborations with recording some artists at home, and Travis, who does the video, he put that together. And just nice to be home and just writing a little bit. I mean, obviously I want to be out playing, and there's been a few gigs here and there, but working on a string quartet, I've been wanting to write a full length string quartet piece for a really long time. And now just doing it.
Yeah.
So I've got a couple movements done. I did a choral work last year for a commission. That was my first commission and first choral piece I ever wrote. And that was really cool. I want to do more of that. So, and a little bit of teaching and, this and that.
I mean, you're right. It's been a good time to sort of reflect and sort of not be under the gun as much, maybe with
Exactly.
creative projects,
I
get
was
some
lucky
space.
enough to work with Resonance Records last year with Eddie Daniels, which was really cool.
Are you on that Yvonne
E
Lenz record?
Yvonne Lenz, yep. Yeah. That
George
was.
Behave himself.
Yes, George. I love George. He's got the biggest heart, but yeah, Klabin. I call him the Klabinator. But that was cool. You'd appreciate it because that Yvonne Lenz record had, well, Dave Grusin and Bob James are on it. And that was just like amazing for me to get to hang, just hang with both those guys and talk to them a little bit. And very special for me. Great opportunity.
I'm actually also flying in 2 weeks. I'm gonna actually fly because Nick Mancini moved to Tulsa, Oklahoma, the vibraphone player, who's a great friend of mine. And he called me up one day and he said, like, you gotta come over. So he booked 3.5 days of studio, and another saxophone buddy of mine, Jason Fabus, so we're gonna fly over together to Tulsa, and I think he has like enough material to record at least 2 CDs if he wants to. So we're going to hit the studio there, and he has 2 gigs booked that week as well, live gigs. So I'm very much looking forward to some normalcy again.
Getting out of town is good.
That too.
All right. Well,
It'll
safe
be good.
travels, and it's great. Thanks for, inviting me to contact, talk with you guys.
Oh, thank
Yeah,
you,
of course.
John.
This
This was
was a
so much
blast.
fun.
I'll
It'll be
try to tune
great.
in. I don't have Facebook right now, so
Oh.
it's hard for me to tune in. But now I see you got YouTube, so I'll start following you on YouTube.
Keep
Yeah,
post
and
them up there.
well, I've seen here on the Facebook feed that your wife Lorna has been like plugging all of
Yeah,
the
Lorna.
tracks.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Doing an
She puts
amazing
all the
job with it. Yeah.
Josh, maybe we should hire Lorna to do all
I
of that
know,
plugging
Lorna, you're
stuff on
killing it.
Facebook.
Not a bad idea. Monkestra is actually Lorna's band. I'm telling you. It's her band. I just write the music, and I'm the MD. Lorna is it's her band. She's got that
The band bomb.
So
Yeah, more
cool.
than that, man. She is the catalyst
She
for
said
sure.
something really nice here. She said, "As John's wife, I can share that he loves merging, mingling, mixing stuff. Other night, it was Japanese bonito flakes sprinkled over pesto pasta. This creates craving for new tastes." I love
Yeah. I mean,
that.
if you start drinking wine before you cook, anything is possible. That's right. That's
Heyo.
right. I can dig that for sure.
Yeah.
Hello, Lorna.
Speaking of which, it's 6 o'clock right now. Maybe it's time to have a
Hey, happy hour.
That's right. That's right. I'm definitely down for that.
Yeah.
On that note, we're gonna say goodbye to all of our lovely viewers. Thank you so much for joining again, all of the killing cats that also said hi. We love all of you guys, and we hope that you guys stay well. Our thanks to the great piano player, composer, arranger, band leader, John Beasley, for this great interview. Thank you so much, John. And we both obviously hope to see you very, very soon again in normal times. And for next week, we have the incredible drummer and band leader Joe LaBarbera as our guest. So definitely tune in for that. So we'll see all of you guys next week again. Thank you, guys.
Where's the theme?
We don't
It's a
have a
good
theme
question.
yet. That's true.
Josh, get to work. Let's get to work.
That'll work. That is catchy. That is
Yeah, that's
so
right.
something about it. Yeah. No, good idea, John. I think we'll maybe I'll have to write something. Yeah, the Steve Allen Show kind of vibe,
Something
Yeah.
really
That's
corny. Really corny.
Totally.
Maybe Terry can help us with that.
Ah,
Terry
nice. Terry
Gibbs.
Gibbs. Yeah, right. Yeah, thank you so
All
much,
right, you guys
John.
take care and stay
All right,
safe. You
John.
too.
Vote,
Congrats.
everybody, please vote. Please vote.
I can't, but I'm definitely saying vote. Vote.
Visualize for us
That's right.
then.
That's
Well
right.
said.
All
All
right. Bye-bye.
right,
Thank you,
bye-bye.
John.
Yeah.
Okay, my friend.